Now is the time to get into the Word of God, and the topic for this evening is Bitten to Live. The topic for this evening is Bitten to Live, and the text is from Numbers chapter 21 verses 4 to 9. The text is from Numbers chapter 21 verses 4 to 9. And let us all give reverence to the name of the living Lord. If you are physically able, please stand up so that we give glory and honor to Him as we read this wonderful blueprint to salvation. Numbers chapter 21 verses 4 to 9. And I'm reading from the NKJV. And it goes like this. Then they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. And the soul of the people became very discouraged on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and our soul loathes this worthless bread. So the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that He take away the serpent from us." So Moses prayed for the people. Verse 8 says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it should be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live.' So Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on a pole, and so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. So Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on a pole, and so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived." God bless the reading and the hearing of His word, and please you be seated in the presence of the Most High. And as our custom always reminds us, that before we go down in the presence, before we go deep down into these scriptures, let us invite the Holy Spirit, so that through its presence we have been blessed, so that through its presence we've been teached, so that through its presence we go deep down into an understanding of the Word of God. So I invite you to pray with me as we let go all the distractions around us, so that we focus only and only on the living Lord. Holy, 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 O Lord Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful day which you have given to us, O Lord. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, your favors, O Lord. We thank you, O Lord God, for how good you have been to us. Father, this evening, as we have all gathered together in one accord, like a body of Christ, like your blessed body, O Lord, rejoicing, praising your holy, sanctified name, O Master. Father gracious, fill us up with your Holy Spirit and let go all the distractions around us, O Lord, that your children who have geared up, O Lord God, to listen to thy holy, blessed word, that you should speak to us and it should go deep down into our understanding, that we should live by thy word. In the blessed name of Jesus we pray, amen and amen. A wonderful text we have here, a nice and precise and crisp story which talks about to live when bitten. To live when bitten. To give you a small briefing on this chapter, we see that the children of God are all moving around in wilderness, and they are traveling from one place to another, and there are other Canaanites who are living, there are other people who are living, there are other tribes who are living, there are a lot of other people around them, and they were kind of passing over them. And was one such a tribe is the tribe of the Edomites. And when they wanted to pass through them, when they wanted to enter through their land to move on and to move forward, they were strongly being stopped by the king, and the Edomites did not allow them to move forward. Now, when such a thing happened, the children of God were all very disappointed, because a new detour had come on their way. They have to move to a different direction so that they could move forward towards the plans which God had led them unto. So today, with the power, with the presence, with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, let us go deep down into these simple verses from verse 4 to 9 to have an understanding on what life lessons can we learn from them. To have an understanding then what the scripture is speaking, is teaching to us this evening. When we go to 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 16 and 17, it talks about the way we look at the book, the way we look at this wonderful book called the Bible. It says that all scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So before we've been taught by the Holy Spirit, this is what the scripture is emphasizing upon, that as we learn it, it brings in profit to us. It brings in good things to us. It teaches us. It makes us to understand. It corrects us if we are on the wrong track. And most importantly, it brings in a completeness in the work which God has laid in our life. So my friends, my family, my beloved, let's all gear up in understanding that what the word of God has in store for each and every one of us this evening. The verse 4, which had been read out to you, which said that, then they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, and the soul of the people became very discouraged on the way. The soul of the people became discouraged on the way. My friends, my family, my beloved, when we try to come closer to God, when we take up a step in faith, when we try to move a step forward, taking the name of the blessed Lord, most of the time it happens that we become impatient, we become discouraged because of the way life turns around, because of the way the situations come in our life. Most of the time it happens because if I talk about myself as an example, when I started coming closer to God, there was so much which the enemy could have brought in. Every blessed day there were challenges. Every blessed day there were issues, concerns. The business was going down. People were stealing. There was so much which was happening. There were issues all around in the family. There was fire break in the house. My car broke down. There was robbery in the house. All the gold, all the important documents, the money which we had, the cash which we had, everything got stolen. But praise be to God that He kept us safe even in those times of trouble. But what happens is, during such events in life, when you try to take a step in faith and say, God, I'm going to do what you want me to do. I am going to move forward, O Lord God, on the way which you have planned in my life. That is wherein the enemy gets active. And he gets proactive in everything you do. Proactive in everything you do. Every step you take, there are concerns. There are issues. You will tend to go on to a season of storms in your life. A sudden darkness would come over you. And during this time, there are many voices around us. It can be the voice of your wife, can be the voice of your husband, can be the voice of your family member, your friends, your colleague. And they will come up to you and say, you were better before. You were better before. Why do you want to follow the way? Why do you want to follow Jesus? Why do you want to lay your life onto the path which you want Him to decide in your life? You were better before. Look at yourself. Now you have started to follow Jesus. These are the things which the enemy is bringing in, and these are the things which are pulling you down. These are the things which are taking you down. Why do you want to live such a life? Why do you don't want to go back onto the life which you were happy with? And so did it happen in the life of all these people who had taken a step in faith, who had taken a step in the promise which God had given to them, and now they were all discouraged. Now they were all impatient because they wanted to move ahead onto the promises which God had laid in their lives. But this sudden detour, this sudden change in plans brought in discouragement, brought them to be at a point of being impatient of what they were doing. When we go to Psalm chapter 37, verse 7, it says that be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. This is something which is very, very important for us to understand, my friends, my family, my beloved, because what happens is that when we start walking, when we start moving on to the way which God has laid in our life, and we look on to our brother, when we look on the other side to our sister, when we look on to all those, our friends and family, we see them growing. We see them getting blessed. We see them how comfortable they are with their lives. And we look onto our own life and we see, what kind of a life am I living? Every day I have trials. Every day I have tribulations. Every day there are a set of storms. Every day I'm been banged in and banged out. I've been bashed by everyone. Every day there are situations which are not favoring. Every day I'm going down to the valley. Every day I am being pulled down. Why is all this happening? Whereas my brother, my sister, my friends, they are all enjoying. Look at their life. They are all enjoying. But the word of God is reminding us this evening that be still. Be still and wait patiently. Wait patiently. Do not look at what is happening around you. Do not look at the other people. Do not look at your colleagues. Do not look at what is happening in their life. Just be patient. Because Proverbs chapter 14 verse 29 says that whoever is patient has great understanding. That whoever is patient has great understanding. But one who is quick tempered displays folly. My friends, my family, the word of God is so wonderful. The word of God is so marvelous that every need of ours is being fulfilled through these scriptures. Whenever we are worried, whenever we are excited, whenever we come to a point where we do not know what to do, the word of God speaks to us. The word of God reveals us, brings peace to us. The word of God gives us encouragement. The word of God gives us an understanding that I am there with you. I am upholding you. Do not worry about your situation. I am in control. Because that is what the living Lord is speaking to us this evening. That be patient. Because patience brings in great understanding. Patience brings in great understanding. The second thing which most of us do most of the time is we tend to live in the past and defile God's presence. We fail to live in the past and defile God's present as well. Because if you see that every blessed day is a present which God has given to us. Every blessed day, if we are able to breathe, it's a present from the living Lord. Every blessed day, if we are able to see another date on the calendar, if we are able to see our family, if we are able to see our friends, if we are able to see another day, it's a present from the living Lord. But what happens is, when we tend to become impatient, when we lose control, when we really are broken down, that is the time where we start remembering the past which we were into. We start remembering the old good days. We start remembering that I was better back then. My life was comfortable. I was enjoying. I used to go to church or to the sanctuary. I used to hear the word of God sometimes. And God was okay with it. I used to praise and worship Him sometimes and He was fine. Because I didn't see any of my problems so far. Because I felt that I was okay when I was in Egypt. I felt that I was fine there. I had good things to eat. I had good things to wear. I had a better lifestyle when I was in Egypt. So did it happen in the life of all the children of God. When they were defiling God. When they were complaining to God. When they were questioning them. When they were questioning to Him and saying, God, what have you done? Why have you brought me to this point? You have brought me here to die and I have been complaining on the same again and again and again. But yet, I am not satisfied with what you are doing with this life of mine. I was better off in Egypt. I had food to eat. I had water to drink. Every day you are giving this worthless manna to me. Every day you are giving this food which you say is even the angels have not eaten, but you are giving this same thing every day. How long can we take this? How long can we live on it? How long can we cherish or enjoy? How long can our taste buds? How long can our taste buds taste the same food? We are tired of all this, O Lord. We are tired. We are tired. My friends, my family, this is the same thing. The same thing which we face in our life. When we go in our prayers, when we go in our time, where our broken heart starts to speak to God, we ask Him that, what are you doing in my life, O Lord? Why am I so broken? Why am I so broken? Why are you not coming to rescue me? Your word talks about so much, O Lord, the promises which you have. But yet, I don't see them. I don't see them manifesting in my life. Why have you left me, my Lord? And why am I eating the same food every day? Why am I wearing the same clothes every day? Why am I doing the same thing every day, O Lord? Why am I doing the same thing every day? I was better off with my life in Egypt. I was better off when I was living in Egypt. My friends, my family, my beloved, our Lord is a good Lord. Our Lord is a gracious Lord. But sometimes in our anger, or sometimes when we are impatient, or sometimes when we don't understand His plan, we tend to speak out things which are not right. We tend to be angry on him. We tend to be a very complaining type. And then we start complaining and speaking out things which even God does not like, because he is our provider. That is what the Bible says, that he is our provider. He is Jehovah Jireh, who provides, who takes care. He is always there. And the word of God says that I will never leave you nor forsake you. But yet, we do not understand his love. We do not understand his love. And so, our friends did the same thing. They started defiling God. They started complaining. They started talking against God. And what do we see when such a thing happens? That when they start talking against God, when they start talking and insulting the blessings of God, we see that God sent serpents among them, and they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. And God sent serpents among them, and many of the people, his own people, his own children, they died. My friends, my family, my beloved, if we look deeply unto the grace which God has given to us, itself it's a blessing that every day we are able to get food on our table, if we are able to sleep on the bed, if we are able to have shelter, if we are able to have a healthy life, that itself is a blessing. But then we tend to strive more. We tend to increase our expectations more from God. God does not say that I will not live by your expectation. God in fact says, I will give you more than what you have even wanted. I will give you more than what you have even thought of. I will make you to see those things which you have never ever seen before. Because his promises, his understanding is greater than ours. But here we see that after his children started defiling, he sent the serpents so that the serpents could go and kill them, so that the serpents could go and bite them. Now, one important thing for us to understand is, where did the serpents come from? Where did the serpents come from? My friends, my family, my beloved, it's very important for us to understand God's providence in our life. It's very important to understand God's protection in our life. Where did the serpents come from? When we look deep into the scriptures to an understanding, the serpents were not sent from heaven. The serpents were not sent from the earth. The serpents were not sent from somewhere else. Then from where did the serpents come? When we have an understanding, on this question, the Holy Spirit is making us to understand that the serpents were there. The serpents were there. The scorpions were there. Trouble were there. Problems were there. Situations were there. But the presence of the good Lord was leading them in the wilderness. The presence of the good Lord were with them in the wilderness. And when they spoke against the good Lord, when they spoke against him, he took his hand. He took his hand of protection. He just took it back. And when he took it back, the serpents came in the picture. When he took his hand of protection, the serpents came in the picture. My friends, my family, my beloved, this is for you and I to understand that this journey of ours, this life which God has given to us, when we look around, there is so much which is happening in this world. People are dying. Virus is there. Trouble is there. You name it, things are there. And the word of God says this is nothing. The word of God says this is nothing because more is going to come. More and more is going to come. What do we do then? What do we do then? Very simple. Walk under His protection. Walk under the protection of the good Lord. When we go back into the scripture and we see that when the children were walking down into the wilderness, the pillar of cloud, God's very presence, the pillar of cloud was leading them. The pillar of fire was with them in the night. And the pillar of cloud was there during the day. And they were walking and walking and walking into the wilderness. None of them got stung by the serpents or the scorpions. None of them had very, very sandals. None of their clothes were torn. None of their sandals were wearied. None of that happened to them. They were growing in the presence of the living Lord. Just think about it. Try to think about it. A boy who's of age 10 and he is walking in the presence of the good Lord. A guy or a girl, they are growing in His presence. But how are they being provided with all the provisions? God is blessing them. God is blessing them. How come their sandals are not getting wearied out? How come their clothing were not getting torn off? Everything, every such thing has a life. When you and I, we wear our shoes, when you and I, we wear our clothes, they do get torn or they do get spoiled or they do get smaller in size. But here we see that God, under His providence, He is taking care of every small thing. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you and I this evening that let us stop our complaining nature. Let us understand that what God is giving to us, that He is nurturing and nourishing our life towards the way which He has promised to each and every one of us. When the children of God, they were defiling and talking ill against the manna which came down from heaven, when they were talking ill against the bread of life which was nourishing them, the bread of life which was taking care of them, the bread of life which were filling their stomach, the bread of life which was taking care of their hunger, when they were starting to defile and to talk against it, that is when the protection was taken from them and the enemy came in to attack them. My friends, my family, my beloved, I do not know about you, but I feel the presence of the Most High. I feel the holy presence of the Most High, and the Holy Ghost is there and speaking to each and every one of us. Receive a change in your life and understand that if you are doing wrong by defiling God through your life, through your words, through your actions, through all what is not right in the sight of the living Lord, change your ways so that God's supernatural providence, should again come and overshadow you, should again come and take control over you, should again come and nurture you, should again come and nurture your lives. The second point for us to understand here is the RNR which happened in the life of the children of God. That is realization and repentance. Realization and repentance. I know the word of God this evening will take some time. Please do not look at the watches. Do not look at the time. Let the time pass, because you should be in the presence of the Most High so that you get anointed. Because these are all life lessons. My friends, my family, my beloved, these are all life lessons. And I challenge you today. I challenge you in His name. I challenge you in the name which is above all any other thing in this world. I challenge you, being His servant, that when you practice these life lessons, when you practice the word which is being preached to us this evening, you will see a change. You will be a testimony. You will see a change in your blessed life. When we go to verse 7, it says, therefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned. Moses, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that He takes away the serpents from us. So Moses prayed for the people. Second Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14 says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn away from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. And I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Such a wonderful promise which God is giving to us this evening, that if we humble ourselves, that if we humble ourselves and pray to Him and seek His face, that is seeking His presence, that is seeking His will, that is seeking His holy anointing, that is seeking the promises which He has laid in our life, that is seeking His holy face. And then He says that I will take away and forgive you from all your sins. Realization is something which is very, very important. Because if I am not realizing the wrong which I am doing, how can I repent towards it? If I do not know if this is right or wrong, then how can I repent? How can I be sorry about it? If today I am insulting someone, and I feel that this insult is a good insult because that person deserved it, then what kind of a repentance, forget about repentance, then what kind of a realization will I have? Because I feel in my own self that what I have done is right. So very important for us to understand that if we are living a life which is not right in the sight of the living Lord, first is to realize that what we are doing, is it right or wrong? And if we know that the wrong which we have done, let us humble ourselves. Let us humble ourselves. Let us go down on our knees. Let us cry out to the Lord and say, Father, I know the wrong I have done. Father, I know this life which you have given to me, I am not living the way you want me to live, O Lord. Father, mend me, touch me, cleanse me through the blood of your beloved Son, Lord Jesus, that I may be washed, that I may be sanctified, that I may be consecrated, O Lord, and mark me with the blood of His, that I should be used, O Lord God, for you and your blessed kingdom. My friends, my family, my beloved, this should be the prayer which we should pray every blessed day. Because no life is a life worth. No life is a life worth if the life is not lived to give glory to God. No life is a life worth if the life is not lived to give glory to God. And when the children of God came to Moses, they said, Moses, our friend, Moses, our brother, we know the wrong we have done. And we request you to pray to God, intercede for us. Intercede so that we are being forgiven by Him. Now, very important thing, especially where it says that then Moses prayed for them. So Moses prayed for them. What do we understand from this? What do we understand with this simple sentence which says, so Moses prayed for them? What happens in our life, and especially the ones who are praying? I'm talking about the pastors, talking about the leaders, talking about all those children of God who tend to pray for others, who tend to intercede, even the prayer warriors. Very important lesson to be learned from this simple sentence which says, so Moses prayed. You know, when we are in this life and when we live in this fallen world, what happens most of the time, and it is very natural, I'm not complaining about it, it's very natural and very human as well, that what happens is that when someone talks ill against us, when someone talks bad against us, when someone talks something which is not good to hear, and if that someone comes to us and says, Pastor, pray for me. Brother, pray for me. Sister, pray for me. Do we really pray with that heart? Or it is only the words which come out? Or sometimes we might even say that, sorry, I am busy, I cannot pray for you. Or sorry, I cannot pray because what you have done to me, I cannot overcome it. But here we see in the scriptures, so Moses prayed. So Moses prayed. The children of God came to Moses and said to Moses that, brother, we have talked against God. We have talked against you. We have done things which are not right. And we have spoken bad because we thought that you are not a good man. You have brought us to die. We were following you, but you are a bad person and we spoke against you. But now we want you to pray for us. And the word of God says, so Moses prayed. Moses prayed. My friends, my family, my beloved, this should be the attitude which we should have. This should be the attitude which we should have in our prayer life. That no matter what comes across us, that no matter what happens, because do not let your prayer life get influenced with external factors. Do not let your prayer life get influenced with external factors, and do not be selective intercessor. Do not select that whom you are going to pray for. Anyone who approaches you to pray, just pray, because that itself is a blessing. Do not think that what he or she has spoken to you. Do not think whether he is your brother, your sister, your relative, your family, your XYZ. Just pray. Pray. And when that prayer gets answered, God is going to bless you. God is going to bless you. You will be uplifted. Just think about it. Just think about it. What joy would it bring to a heart? What joy would it bring to a heart of a person who has prayed for someone, and that someone's prayer, or that someone whom you prayed for, became a testimony, or that someone whom you prayed for, that prayer got answered? What joy it would bring to your very heart. And so we see in the life of Moses that he was a humble man. That he was a humble man, and though people spoke against him, he still prayed for them. He still prayed for them. Verse 8 says, then the Lord said to Moses, Moses, my child, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live. Now here, when Moses prayed, the prayer got answered, and God said, well, I have heard the prayer which you have prayed, Moses, and I will do something which will take care of the situation. I will bring a solution to the problem. I will answer your prayer, but this is what you have to do. And he said that, take a serpent, put it on a pole, and whoever is bitten should look at it, and they will live. Now, one simple thing which sometimes I used to wonder before going deep into an understanding of this word, that God is Jehovah Rapha. God is a mighty healer. God can do wonders. He is a sovereign God. He can do mighty things, and he has also done it in the past. He is still doing it, and he will do it again in the future. But why did God give an instruction of a serpent to be set on a pole? Why did God give such an instruction of a serpent to be set up on a pole? The simple answer to this is, because this is what God wants. God says that when I give you an instruction, just follow it. No ifs, no questions asked. And the simple answer is that God expects obedience, and obedience to live by his word. God expects obedience, and obedience to live by his word. When we read Exodus chapter 15 verse 26, here is a something. These verses are something which will summarize God's sovereignty. It says that if you listen carefully to the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes. Pay attention to this, please. When you carefully listen to what the good Lord is speaking to you and I, and pay attention to his commands, and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians from. I am the Lord who heals you. For I am the Lord who heals you. A very nice and wonderful story we see in this Exodus chapter 15, where the children of God are walking through the wilderness, and they are thirsty, and when they come near a small lake, near a small oasis to be particular with, and when they try to drink the water is bitter. The water is bitter. And they again start crying as usual, and they say that this water is not drinkable. What do we do, Moses? You have again brought us into trouble. And Moses, as usual, prays to God, and God gives an instruction that take a log, put it, throw it in the water, and the water will be sweet. Wow, what kind of science is this? What kind of a science is this? Just think about it. What kind of a science is this, that if you are holding a glass of water which is bitter, you just put in a small log into it, you put in some wood into it, and it would become sweet? You would not understand. You and I will not understand. But this is what God said, and they all followed. And what happened? We all know what happened thereafter. The water became drinkable. The water became sweet. The water was no more bitter. The word of God is speaking to you and I and all those people who have joined online, that when you read about the sower, when you read about the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13 verses 19 to 22, it talks about three wonderful hearts. It talks about three wonderful people. It talks about them and says that what kind of a person you are, or what kind of a heart you have, what kind of a field is there in your heart, that when the word has been given to you, what do you do with it? Do you take out from one ear, you listen from one, you take out from the other, or does it go deep into your heart? Does it stay there? Does it manifest there? Or when you see trials and temptations in your life, when you see that the enemy has brought in trouble to you, you take that word, throw it in the bin, and then you go with the enemy hands in hand? Or what kind of a life you are? Do you live by the word and allow the word to be manifested in your life? Do you allow God's presence to be manifested in your life? Do you allow His will to be manifested in your life? Do you allow God's mighty presence to be filled in your life? Or you are like the rocky place or the thorny bushes or the path on which the word was being casted on and nothing could manifest, because end of the day, whatever you received, it just went on. Very important, my friends, my family, my beloved. God expects, please understand, God expects obedience. In obedience to His word. Whatever is written in the Bible is no joke. Whatever is written in the Bible is no joke. It holds importance. It holds life. It holds the Spirit of the Most High. It holds God Himself. And when the word speaks to us, that word manifests when we receive it in all fullness. That word will manifest when we receive it in all fullness. That is why Jesus says that when you live by the word, in obedience, you will bear fruit. You will have a bumper crop, 100% harvest. A bumper crop, 100% harvest. My friends, my family, my beloved. Oh, I am really blessed today, because the way the Holy Spirit is moving around, the way the Holy Spirit is hovering around, the Holy Spirit is giving us one after the another. It is blessing us with such wonderful delights that live by the word and live in obedience and see how God will manifest in your life, how God will bless you, how God will mightily uphold you and uplift you. That no matter when you are in this fallen world, no matter what is happening around you, when you say, God, I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. No matter what happens, He will say, do not worry, I am there. I am the true shepherd. I will lay my life for my sheep. I will be with you to the very end of this earth. I will give you what you have never seen before. I am your salvation. I am your life. I will give this eternal life to each and every one who believes in obedience and lives by His word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Shout out to the name of the living Lord for how good He is and how blessed are His works. Now this brings us to the takeaway for the evening. And the takeaway for the evening is bitten to live. The takeaway for the evening is bitten to live. Verse 9 says, so Moses made a bronze serpent. Moses made a bronze serpent. The instruction given by God to Moses was to make a fiery serpent. But Moses made a bronze serpent and he put it on a pole. And so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. Now again, we have a question. And the question comes to you all as well, that why God chose a serpent among all? That among all the creatures, among all what we see in this world, why did God choose a serpent? Because personally, if I talk about serpents, I do not like them. And I'm sure most of us, we do not like snakes. We do not like serpents. We do not like even to hold them, to touch them, and to even look at them. Because one such thing as a snake, if it even crawls around you or in your backyard, you will certainly go and kill it, or you might even run away because you are scared, you are afraid of them. But why did God choose a serpent in all? The answer is quite simple. Again, it says a reminder. A simple word. It says a reminder to all. What is a reminder? Now, scientifically, when we look on ourselves, every human being does not forget visuals. What we see and experience, we remember. What we see and experience, we remember. Today, even if I question or talk to my son or to my father or to my mother or to my brothers or anyone, and if I ask them, do you remember the movie which we saw in this year where it was XYZ starrer and all? Most of them, they would relate to it and say, yes, we do. Because that is how the human mind is. Whatever we see, whatever visuals come to our eyes, we remember. We remember them. We remember them. You can talk about movies. You can talk about the songs which you hear. You can talk about the events which happened in your school or in your college. Even in your childhood days, some of the events or majority of the events which you had gone through, you remember them because you are part of it. You are into it. You could see it. You can relate to it. You experienced it. And that is why you can remember them. Now the question has been answered that why did God say to take a serpent? Because when we look at the serpent, that when the children of God looked at the serpent, it gave them a reminder that see what you have done. Look at what you have done. You spoke against me. You spoke against my plans. You spoke against my promises. You spoke against the nourishment which I was nourishing you with. You spoke against the holy bread. You spoke against everything. But yet, this is my love for you. This is my grace for you. This is my favor for you. This is your God, your Father for you. That in spite of all this, you are getting healed. You are being lived upon. You are getting healed. A very nice quote, a very nice verse which we see in John chapter 3 verses 14 to 15, which Jesus quoted and said, he said that, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever, listen to this very carefully, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. My friends, my family, my beloved, a big question to you and I this evening. What do we see when we look at the cross? What do we see when we look at the cross? When we look at what Jesus has done to us, he has paid a price which no one can pay. He has taken it all on him. You and I were supposed to be there, hanging on that cross. You and I were supposed to be there, bleeding on that cross. You and I were supposed to be there because of what we have done, the sins which we have committed, the wrongs which we have done, the life which we were living even now. You and I are supposed to be there. But he took it all. He took it all. And that is why he even says in John chapter 3, that I will be raised. Like how the serpent had given life, similarly I will be raised to give life to you and life in abundance. But there is a catch to it, and the catch is that whosoever believeth, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. That whosoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. My friends, my family, my beloved, we are living in this fallen world. I just want you to close your eyes. Close your eyes. Even people who are online, please close your eyes. Close your eyes and speak to your Father, speak to your God. We are living in this fallen world. We are living in this fallen world. And we are even bitten by the serpent who is in this fallen world. Because the word of God says that Satan is a deceiver. That enemy who is the accuser is a deceiver. And every day he deceives us. Every day he bites us. Every day we are being bitten by him. And the most sad part of all is, that we do not even know that we are being bitten by the enemy. That we do not even know that the enemy is in control over our lives. We do not even know that the enemy has taken over our lives. And most importantly, we do not know which direction to do. We do not even know that where we have to look at so that we can receive healing. My friends, my family, my beloved, the word of God says, which even Jesus spoke those years back, that I have come to heal the sick. I have come to heal the sick. I have not come for the healthy ones. I have not come for the healthy, righteous ones. Because the word of God this evening is speaking to all those folks, all those people, all those who are being bitten. Because this is what God spoke to Moses, and this is what the Holy Spirit is speaking to you and I this evening, that who all are bitten? Who all are bitten in this fallen world should look at the life, should look at Jesus and live. Should look at Jesus and live. My friends, my family, my beloved, we have fallen short because of the way we are living in this life. We fall short of the glory of God because of the way we are living this life. But yet, out of His grace, out of His mercy, out of His love, God is speaking to you and I through the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Through the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Realize the wrong which you and I have done and repent and look at Jesus, because He is the only bread of life. He is the only source of life, and He is the only all in all who can deliver us from all this misery, from all this trouble, from all this anxiety, from all this problem, from all what we are facing, because He has given His life for us. He has shed His precious blood for us. He has taken our beatings. He has taken all the condemnation, the sin, all the wrong, the filth which we were living in. He has taken it all on the tree, on that cross, and He has conquered it all. He has conquered it all, and He has been resurrected to give life to us. And that gift He is offering to you and I. Let us all receive it in the name of Jesus. Let us all receive it in the name of Jesus. Whatever the enemy has planned, it will all get cancelled. Whatever the enemy has brought forward and bitten us with will all get cancelled. And we will live. We will live in the name of Jesus. We will live a life which He has given to us. And we will live the eternal life. God bless you all. Amen. 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 Receive it in His name. Amen.